Mini chapter 118, Torment on Mount Lee. Climax. When we screen these things for you, Dad, I do wish you'd be more present, Amber coos across at him. You mean less vacant, puts in Scorpio. Oh, Dad, sighs Amber, smiling across the width of the tower. Dad, 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 have you perchance come to recognize that transcendence, vengeance, and fierce beauty would seem to have won out over dreariness, laziness, and smallness? Could it be that the complexity, unconventionality, beauty, and subtlety of truth in this private screening stand in contrast with the simplicity, convention, utility, and obviousness of lies in Ain't They Freaky, as an implicit challenge by example? Or is that a leading question, Dud? As if battling a new understanding, Dud speaks at last. Fuck all that shit! Give me Ain't They Freaky every time! The Jaymi beast nods. You may find the following uncomfortable or unnerving, he says. Dud's scalp prickles, as he senses a scrutiny he knows from above him on the right. He felt it once before from a glossy photograph of a motel by a liquor store where Evelyn was firing out murderous challenge from inside her sunny printed smile at him. And he felt it in Westmont just ahead of him, flitting up the steps to the motel's upper level. Was that her? But then the walkway was deserted. Glancing somehow down at him now, her challenge from that photo has become more murderous, seemingly equipped with a terrible new knowledge of Bangdead's attempt to warp her sunlight into brassy, sleazy cartoon simpleness. And visible in her eyes, despite Jamie's consigning this to the category of Evelyn's avoided destinies, is the watermark of her standing alone in the bar downstairs, while her friends all peeped at her from alcoves and corners in search of the girl they used to love before Bangdead's smudging wrought a weird mutilation of her presence, which none of them could pin down, but made them all think, oh, poor creature, and what has gone so wrong with her? Another gaze pricks Dud's awareness from above him on the left, where he cannot stop himself looking up. And there looms Kim's face with its own terrible new knowledge of Bangdead's having smudged him. Around Kim's eyes is a rubbery ultramarine, the irises an unhealthy orange ochre, the whites standing out bright against that convexity of skin like egg yolks in outspread dark blue blubber. And sad behind these colours, despite Jamie's consigning this to the category of Kim's avoided destinies, is the watermark of his desire to be close to that girl in Spindle Wood, while Bangdead's hacking made him frighten her instead with a grimace and a savage snarl of, what is that meant to mean? Staining both his life and hers forever. Dud looks down, evasive, but floating up the height of the transmitter tower towards him is the face of Shigim, with his own terrible new knowledge of Ashley's and Dud's attack, when a highway of drifters with faces of pain and defeat stretched away in him. And large in Shigim's gaze, despite Jamie's consigning this to the category of Shigim's avoided destinies, is the watermark of Bangdead's hack, cowering behind that podium in the nightclub hallway, breathing hard, streaming tears of horror, with the skin of his nape punctured by the end of Kruger's metal fingernail. From above Dud comes a hiss of pink noise. He looks up ahead, and there are the accusatory eyes of the Platinum Raven, with her own terrible new knowledge of Bangdead's hack, when she felt like dying, filled with the black slab, her guts made of stone, perceiving that no one knew about the diamond pipe slashing through her rocks, and nobody in future would ever know about it, so that all her platinum transcendence would remain stillborn and forever unexpressed. And bitter in her gaze, despite Jamie's consigning this to the category of the Platinum Raven's avoided destinies, is the watermark of her image on the side of that building on Hope Street, in Bangdad's smudging of her. Fakeness and theft of her, attributed as copyright Bangdead Games. Dud flinches as a fifth beast hisses up before him like a starved baby she-wolf, champing through the sticky air, floating ever nearer, leaking hatred out at him. It's Scorpio, his sexy vermin beast face, blooded by a terrible new knowledge of his own incipient panic attack in the fluorescent flicker of that late-night cinema washroom, the evil in the mirror grinning out from the side of his own face and body, and the man brushing up against Scorpio on the side where the evil grinned. And harsh in Scorpio's throat, despite Jamie's consigning this to the category of Scorpio's avoided destinies, can be heard the watermark of that five-year-old girl's voice grating in the corridor, and through her gauzy veil, all those lines around her eyes. Amber rears up and stands in the floodlight ahead, surrounded by the other beasts. Central in his insides, a long black heart pounds the darkest drive around him and outward through the humid air. He focuses on Dart, and a negative desire flashes up through his face with a smudge and flash of anger. His expression splits, a smile beneath his nose, but not above it. Seen from one angle, it's a smile like a meat cleaver. Seen from another, there is nothing but a flicker at his lips, like a flame beneath a tomb. Words churn in a broth in Amber's skull, and then are aimed at Dud, not through the beast's mouth, but through the north side of his face. Unspoken, they're as sharp as a knife through flesh. How I'd love to kill you off by using noise alone, at just the right frequency and volume, so your frame would disintegrate, and soon you would be scooping up your guts from the floor. Drifting nearer, Amber's face retains his customary wide-set fluidity of humour, yet under this is an altogether darker energy. Disgusted cruelty, insane with revulsion, its eyes scrunched closed, and the cords in its neck standing out. Those unspoken words from the side of Amber's face continue. Your head will be severed, then buried in the garden at Jupiter Drive, facing up towards the house, so I'll always imagine it buried there, staring up at me from the earth beneath my bow window day and night. Despite his slow floating ever closer into Dud, Amber somehow feels rather to be jumping straight at his face, with fingernails gripping the back of Dud's head in order to do more damage. Guts seem to surge out of Amber's smiling eyes at the tubby piece of dead meat flailing on the tower. And yes, with the speeding up of blood to drive the meat mad and maximize the hurt, it is time for Amber's nuke switch to get flicked on, and for Dud to take the highest trip, listening to the sound of his own blood rushing from his head like a geyser. What a rush! From Dud's viewpoint, the first effects of the nuke switch's flicking on seem almost low-key. This will soon be revealed as an illusion, but meanwhile those effects begin simply with a clearer perception of his own stagnant, grey-caging malice, which he sees has infected the rest of him. He sees the lazy cheapness and stupidity of his tabloid output, and the sickeningly dreary evil of this. Such busy labour throughout his years and decades, like a grey clogged residue pushed out and lain in. A perverted life, perhaps? Nah, no regrets, mate. He'd do it all again, every fucking shred of it, every time. From those opening flashes, Dud's growing self-perception proceeds to a sense of self-allergy. Whatever years might have remained to him from now on, they'd have been irremediably oppressed and greyed out by the revelation of this permanent stain in him, underlying every other event and leaving everything tainted for him. From here on, he senses, his life would have felt as if he once strangled to death his own identical twin while in the womb, knowing the extraordinary misery and pain the twin would have experienced if he'd been allowed to be born. The stench of imbalance, failure, and wasted resources inside him is now so overpowering as to be incapable of dispersion, it seems. One specific effect of this is to morph his memory of the palatial Blue Jay Way house into a dirty, squalid little apartment instead, with the television always on, a life-sized, stuffed toy dog sitting in one armchair, and Dud in the other armchair, and on the wall of the pokey hallway, a snapshot of Dud when he was young, before the stain arrived. Half asleep in front of a game show, he feels his armchair pressing him up against the ceiling of the apartment. Across the room, a green plastic bag of junk on the floor looks like a series of grotesque heads, half buried under the floor as he stares at it. Near ahead, not far beyond his toes, a corpse looks up at him through the carpet. He jumps up, wailing, and runs from the room, catching sight of his own hideously burned face in a mirror, and bolts down the hallway, where a faceless head pursues him through a dense maze of furniture that blocks the front door. But, with a jolt, he wakes again on the tower to find the giant face of Amber has floated down upon him. Terrified, he writhes, but his limbs are immobilized, tied to the metal. Amber reaches out his left hand to the top of Dud's skull and runs the long nail of his index finger in a hard circle down into the bone dome. He lifts the resultant circular lid, drops a wriggling thing inside it, infernal and bestial, then drops the skull lid closed again. The glands of Dud's emotion pump sticky tears out from his right eye first, then his left. His skull tries speaking this aloud, through the flesh that surrounds it and cushions it, but cannot. As if from above, he can still see himself here, lashed to the highest red-painted band of the tower's framework, with his arms outstretched to either side, his feet together beneath him, and his head tilted down to one side, a bag of chemicals and fluid on a scaffolding of pain. And streaming from this bag of a body, while Dud watches, it seems that a red metal fluid mingles with the rain spatters, and flows down the spreading width of struts and girders, down over the highest white-painted band, over the next red band, the next white band, another red and another white, to the lowest red, until, from the base of the tower, red and white metal tongues run across the ground, halt and harden, then crack open and bleed into earth. Tiny in the far west, helicopters circle like gnats above Stone Canyon, whose trees sway and screech in a storm that hasn't reached Mount Lee yet. Once it does, thunder and lightning will play about this tower, every bolt threatening to sizzle dud like a bacon rasher. Meanwhile, splodgy drops of rain spatter down onto the girders beside him, and dogs yelp and howl on the nighttime slopes of the canyons below.